It's not that loud.
My name is Karen Rock, and I'm the Director of Multicultural Activities here at COCC, and it is pure delight to see so many folks who would be willing to come out on a cold and icy evening and make your way across snowbanks and icy sidewalks to be here tonight. So thank you for that. I don't know if you know this, but this program is part of our 9th annual Season of Nonviolence. And before I go into my whole spiel, if I could just have us all check our cell phones and take the ringers off. Remind me to do the same in mine. Okay, so I know many of you have been to the Season of Nonviolence events before, so you already know this, but our Season of Nonviolence honors the legacies of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Mahatma Gandhi, Cesar Chavez, and Chief Wilma Mankiller. And this season is part of an international campaign that remembers the work of Dr. King and Gandhi for their vision of an empowered, nonviolent world. The Season of Nonviolence started in the year 1998, which was the 50th anniversary of Gandhi's assassination, and also that same year was the 30th anniversary of Dr. King's assassination. The dates of their deaths span from January 30th to April 4th, and so this is the time in all of the international communities when we reflect on their work to end oppression to restore equality and respect for everyone. Here at COCC, we also included Cesar Chavez and Chief Wilma Mankiller in our commemoration because of their important contributions for justice and equality as well. And obviously, there are many, many more who have spoken out, who've stood up, who've marched, who've voted, who've been advocates for a long time for justice and equality for all. So I like to say this series is dedicated to all of them and to all of us for that work. So as part of this series, you know you've seen films, you've seen book discussions, library exhibits, and speakers who are all dedicated to demonstrating that nonviolence is a powerful way to heal, transform, and empower our lives and our communities. So this season, I hope, reminds us that our society is not living up to those principles of liberty and justice for all. Oh, yeah. So our education and dedication must continue, and we need the ongoing inspiration from those like our speaker tonight. And I'm particularly honored tonight to welcome Dr. Shakti Butler to be with us. Charlotte's going to do a more formal introduction of her in a minute, but I wanted to share my personal delight that Shakti is here. I first met her several years ago when I was still working in California, and I went to a national conference on diversity where she was previewing one of her films. And I was so impressed with her work then that I invited her to come to our campus in California several times. And when I left there, I've just been waiting for the right moment that could bring her to this campus, and of course, selfishly get to see her again. So glad you're here, Shakti.
Thank you, Karen.
There are a few programs to follow after tonight's event. There's a film that we're showing in February, and then a speaker will talk on refugees and immigration first week in March. Those posters are out in the lobby if you'd like to check those out. And many of you may be involved in the community book discussion that is also going on during this time. Anybody here who is part of those? Oh, great. That's fabulous. There's still space if you'd like to join in our discussion. We're reading the book Racism Without Racists by Eduardo Bonilla Silva. The wonderful thing about this book is it's available online, so it's easily accessible. So posters are out in the lobby if you want to choose one of the book groups that might fit best into your schedule. Lastly, I want to have us thank the many sponsors and partners for the Season of Nonviolence, because without their contributions, this annual program would not be possible, nor would we be able to provide the events free of charge. You've probably been seeing the many logos of these folks on the slideshow behind me, but let me just give us a chance to thank them. So the co-sponsors are COCC's Multicultural Activities and the Nancy R. Chandler Visiting Scholar Program, with the generous financial support from the Deschutes Cultural Coalition, the KC Family Fund of the Oregon Community Foundation, the Oregon Humanities Responsive Grants Program, Deschutes Brewery, Brooks Resources, the Associated Students of COCC, and the Fairfield Inn and Suites by Marriott. Would you join me in giving them all a hearty welcome? And lastly, none of this would happen as smoothly and as well organized or with as much fun if it wasn't for my dear colleague and friend, Charlotte Gilbride. She's the coordinator of the Nancy R. Chandler Visiting Scholar Program. And it is her just deep kindness, her fabulous sense of humor, her dedication to excellence, and just the fun that we have when we're getting ready to plan this event, and we're like, okay, so who do we want to see? Let's invite whoever it is that we're wanting to also get to listen to. So, Charlotte, for all of that, it's great fun with you. Thank you so much.
Hello.
As Karen said, I'm Charlotte Gilbride. Thank you, Karen, for that. I am the coordinator of the Nancy R. Chandler Visiting Scholar Program of COCC Foundation. It's a mouthful. Thanks to Karen, I say the exact same thing back to Karen. Our campus and our community is super lucky to have her in her role at the Multicultural Center at the college. The programming they put on throughout the year is incredible, and she's an awesome colleague. I want to start with some background on COCC Foundation, for those of you who aren't familiar. The foundation was established in 1955, and it exists for the benefit of Central Oregon Community College, its students and faculty, and it supports the educational and charitable activities of our college. We provide financial assistance to students, fiscal support for college programming, and occasionally run campaigns in support of college capital improvement. We're extremely proud to say that for the 2016-2017 school year, we awarded over $1.5 million in student scholarships.
Wow.
The Visiting Scholar Program was established in 1985 by Robert W. Chandler Sr. to honor his wife, Nancy. The Chandlers were owners and editors of Western Communications, and in that role, they hosted guests from around the country and around the world. Nancy Chandler took great delight in sharing the knowledge of these guests with those around her in the community. So the idea behind this program is to continue that tradition, to bring nationally and internationally renowned thinkers to Central Oregon, to continue that and to stimulate conversation and encourage thought through a wide range of topics. So here we are. Two quick announcements. You guys found an eval form on your chair. As always, we love feedback on programming, this one in particular, because we have received grants from several organizations, and we'll be doing grant reporting, so we always want audience feedback from that. So if you guys would take a minute to fill it out and turn it in at the front table to me, or even leave it on your chair, it's fine. And also, if you didn't know, Dr. Butler is doing a workshop tomorrow morning in the same room from 9 to 11. That is also free and open to the public. The workshop is going to be on strategic questioning, which is a process to create knowledge that awakens the possibility of change. She told me at lunch today it would even help me communicate with my teenagers. Anyways. Before I introduce Dr. Butler, she would like us to listen to a little something.
Turn it up.
Rooted in love and justice, World Trust produces film, curricula, workshops, and programs that are catalysts for institutional, structural, and cultural change. She's an inspirational facilitator, trainer, and lecturer who is sought after by schools, universities, public and private organizations, and faith-based institutions. She has produced 4 documentaries: The Way Home, Mirrors of Privilege, Making Whiteness Visible, Light in the Shadows, and Cracking the Codes, the System of Racial Inequity. These films form the core of World Trust's teaching tools and have experienced increased exposure, 23 million views on one clip alone, generating national dialogue and critical thinking that is impacting institutions and communities across the country. Most recently, Shakti served as the diversity consultant and advisor on the Disney animated film Zootopia, which focuses on challenging bias and systematic inequity. Her work incorporates whole body learning through stories, art, movement, and dialogue. Her current film, Healing Justice, Cultivating a World of Belonging, is intended to popularize a national conversation about justice, responsibility, and healing. According to her daughter, she has a husband who adores her, 3 grown children, and 5 grandchildren, ranging from the ages of 4 to 24. She was on the Oprah Winfrey Show in 1995 and facilitated a conversation among the audience who watched the film The Color of Fear, which actually was filmed by her husband Rick, and that inspired her to make her first documentary, The Way Home. I spent the majority of the day with her today, and we are in for a real treat. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Shakti Butler.
Thank you so much. I just have to take you in just a little bit. That's okay, right? Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
I used to teach ninth grade, so that's the problem. I'm actually going to be moving a lot between that space over there and up here because that's how I control the slides. And I wanted to, before we launch into what we're going to be talking about tonight, I want to tell you there's something that I'm trying to figure out how to work with publicly because, you know, you only have so much time. I only have so much time with you. And so I think I want to say it like this. I believe that in order to create a world of belonging where everyone has the opportunity to thrive, it is required that we do deep, deep inner work. What I would call our inner individual work, but also our inner collective work that is linked to broad external change. So internal and external work. I'm always looking for the mirror relationships between what's going on inside my own heart, where I get stuck, where I get confused, and where it is that I step into my own greatness. We are that span of what humanity consists of, right? We have the ability to be amazing and wonderful, and we have the ability to not be so amazing and wonderful. And if we don't look at all of that honestly, deeply, we can't make the world different than how it is. That could launch us onto another conversation about what's the purpose of a human life, but we won't go there right now. But I would like to start with you by doing a conocimiento. So this part of me that is very bossy, as affirmed by my kindergarten teacher on my report card, is going to be asking you to do a couple of things, but please, by all means, do not feel like you have to do what I ask. I would like to ask you, if you have anything in your hands at all, to put it down. It's just for a few minutes. To uncross your legs and put both feet on the floor. And to sit up straight. So put your butt up against the back of the chair. The hole is not big enough for you to fall through. So, because we want the spine to be straight, we want, as if you could feel the space in between each vertebrae going up your back, or as if I were standing over you and like kind of gently pulling you from the top of your head. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to breathe together. And in order to take a deep breath, we have to exhale first. So we're going to exhale, take a deep breath in, hold it for a moment, and then when you let go, just, I mean, really let go, like let go of the day, let go of your thoughts as best you can, relax your shoulders and your face and your jaw, just let go. So should we try it just once? Okay, so exhale first. Breathe in deep. Relax your shoulders and then just let go. Now I'm going to invite you to close your eyes and take three deep breaths at your own pace. Ready? Go. If you're willing and you haven't already done so, please close your eyes. And return to your normal breathing, but notice when you breathe in and you breathe out, which breath is longer or shorter, your in-breath or your out-breath? Is there a coolness and a warmth to the in-breath and the out-breath that you can distinguish? And can you feel your heart beating, your internal drum? With this awareness that you are breathing, that's a good thing. There should be a sense of gratitude that can arise. I'd like to invite you to use your imaginations for a moment and to recall a time in your life when you felt supremely joyful, supremely happy, an incident. The first one that pops up into your mind, of course, if you don't like it, you can pick another one. So pick something. It could be very subtle, or it could be big. It could be watching the sun rise and set. It could be holding your child. It could be something that lets you recognize the specialty of the moment. And whatever that is, look at it as if you could see it from the point of view as being in the audience watching something down on the stage. You're watching yourself engaged in something amazing. What do you see? What do you remember? Remember to put the whole thing back together again, all the parts. Maybe you can even smell something or see the colors or feel your skin being touched by your clothing. Most important, what do you feel? What besides the pleasure, the joy, the gratitude of being able to experience your own happiness for just a moment? What kind of qualities are there that allow this to happen? And then once again, give thanks. And when you're ready, you can take a few more breaths and slowly open your eyes. And notice how you feel. With this capacity to turn your attention inside and to remember a time that's a gift for you, you also can become aware of a quality or something about you that is a gift that you offer freely to others. It could be your courage. It could be your strength. It could be your calm. What is it about you that makes you great? And just name one thing. So now I'm going to ask you to turn to somebody you're sitting next to and tell them a little something about what you just experienced. Maybe that special moment. Not a long story, though, because we don't have a lot of time. But specifically what I'm looking for is a quality that makes you great. And I'll go first, just so I can. I love my grandchildren. I mean, I had like a little parade of moments of Grammy, 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 and the love that I feel through that connection to other human beings who love me back. I give and receive love. And in fact, that's my quality. Love, love is what I offer. But you know, if you cut me off on the freeway at 7 o'clock in the morning, you're not gonna get my love. You're gonna get something else. And so what I'm asking of you as we launch into this short, short time that we have together is that you recognize and appreciate something great about who you are so that you know what the qualities are that accompany that. Like, I can tell you what I'm doing when I'm loving you or loving the sunrise. I know how I operationalize love. That's what I'm asking of you. So just turn to your friend, probably you're sitting next to someone you know, and share a little something with them, even though you think you might know everything about them already. Something about you that makes you great.
No.
What's distracting me is the screen that's up there, which is still the sun. I'm so sorry. Can I turn that off?
Yeah. No. Since it's not.
Okay, that's good. That's fine. I keep looking at it like it's
okay?
My prompt. Yeah, that's totally fine. Go
okay.
Back to your friend.
Okay. All right.
Oh, okay.
One of my two grandsons.
They were both
very infected. One was in preschool and was exposed to everything, and one just started kindergarten, so he's got a whole new exposure.
Right. I see. You're welcome.
They call me Nana.
Your Nana.
Amazing.
Awesome.
I'm more present than I think I've ever in my life when I'm with them. I'm just so committed to being with them.
Nice.
That's the strength.
Nice.
To mention that I found this in the life.
Very nice. I might ask you to share that. Would you be willing?
Sure.
Okay. I'll give you the mic. Ooh. Thank you so much. Sorry.
Lovely.
Thank you. My hands are cold. I'm sorry.
Good morning. I'm Marjorie Carmen.
Hi, Marjorie.
I'm involved with this group. This is a wonderful thing we offer and what you bring.
Oh, well, thank you.
Last
Thanks for
November,
inviting me.
We were here with Anton Troyer, the Native American Ojibwa.
Yeah, somebody, I think somebody was telling me about that. It wasn't you.
Maybe Charlotte.
It must have been Charlotte.
We just had a ball. We just went all over the place with him.
Awesome.
That was great. So this is all what it is. Thank God you exist.
Thank God we exist.
Yeah.
If you see me raise my hand, please raise your hand and stop talking. So we'll get the raise hand part, but it's usually the stop talking part that I'm really after. And I apologize already because I will be cutting you off. You will be talking to each other throughout this time. Can I? I actually had the good fortune to just share with one person, and I invited her to please share what her experience was. And so I'm going to ask her to go first, and I'm going to find out some of the qualities that are in the room. Okay? So. Does everybody know you?
She's spreading my contagion here. That's what I'm trying not to do. Thanks very much. First of all, thank you very much for that introduction. We sometimes do that in our wellness class.
They can't hear you. Just have to.
I've been trying to project in classrooms as it turns this corner. My experience that I share is very similar to yours. And that is the profound love that I feel for my two grandsons and the reason why I'm sick. Because I took care of them both on Friday. One of the things I mentioned in particular is that I feel I can be more present to them than I think I have ever been in my entire life with other human beings. I'm not sure what the secret is, but I know that being a Nana is a very special relationship in a very special place.
Right. Thank you.
Sorry for my voice.
What's your name?
Karen.
So what Karen was just talking about is, and you also said when we talked, that that was your quality, your ability to be present in the moment, and she experiences that with her grandchildren. So what about you? Can you just, a few of you tell me what your quality is that makes you great? What is it? Somebody said something. I can't hear you. Oh, you were just laughing. Oh, okay. A risk taker. We have to have people who are risk takers. What else? Just shout them out.
Audacious.
Audacious. Being audacious. We could have a conversation about that. Yes.
Perseverance.
Tenacity.
Friendly.
Appreciation.
Vulnerability.
Compassion.
Sorry?
Compassion.
Optimism.
Resilience.
What else? Over here. Respect. Yeah.
Empathy.
Openness.
Patience.
Patience. Is there anybody who didn't have a quality? No. But notice that the qualities are related, that they really are our values, our deepest values about who we are and how we can choose to show up in the world. And to be able to notice that is also a great gift. Okay. I wish I had so much more time with you, but that's not the case. So what we were just doing is called conocimiento. Conocimiento means to know, to learn from one another in community. And it comes from the Latino farm workers' work of social justice. And that work says if we are going to be a force for change in the world, we have to know each other. I have to know who you are. I have to honor the qualities that you bring that make the fabric whole. So in this community, even right here tonight, everyone has great qualities. Everybody has times when you fall out of alignment with those qualities. Our job is to notice what gets us back on track, what throws us off, and to understand the behaviors that we have that allow us to step into our greatness. Because we are dealing with social justice, because we are dealing with creating a world of belonging, it's really important that we know what makes us joyful, that we also cultivate that joy is tied to the vision of what the world could be if we do the work and the loving and the caring that's necessary for us to understand what we're walking through, what we're doing. Would somebody who is in close to me right here, read this out loud. I'll give you the mic. Thank you.
Should I stand up?
Yes, please, and say your name.
I'm Sarah.
Hey, everybody.
Everybody knows everybody here, huh? Is that how it goes? No? Okay.
Community exists when people who are interdependent struggle with the traditions that bind them and the interests that separate them so they can realize a future that is an improvement on the past.
Thank you.
Or more.
Right.
Or more.
Yes. Thank you. So just take a moment to read that again for yourself and to see what words stand out for you in that message. Could you shout out some of the words that sing to you?
Interdependent.
Struggle. Traditions, bind,
separate,
improvement,
realize.
And so when we talk about the work that we're doing, it's, I think I like sayings like this that I can hold on to remind myself that we are both different and the same. And we're both great and not so great. We are the both and. of being. We are going to start, because I'm talking about race, I'm just going to ask you these few questions, but then I'm going to ask you one question that you're going to talk about with the person you're sitting next to. So when you think about race, is your life impacted by race? And if so, how? Does it race impact you personally, locally, immediately? Is it about you or is it about others? What can you recall about conversations that you've had about race or race relations or racism? Do you hold yourself inside that conversation or are you looking at it from the outside in? What's the most important image or encounter that you've had regarding race? Have you been afraid of race? This is just for your own self-inquiry, but this is the question I want you to talk to about the person you're sitting next to. When is the first time in your life that you became aware of or noticed race? And I will tell you mine first. So I am the daughter of a West Indian man and a Russian woman. My father was born in Barbados. His father was born into slavery. This is my father I'm talking about. His father, my grandfather, was born into slavery in Austin, Texas. When he was about 9 years old, the emancipation happened. I can see you trying to figure out how this can be. I'm explaining it to you, so don't worry about it. When he was 18, he took a boat to Barbados where he met my grandmother, who was Arawak Indian and black. My great-grandmother was full Arawak Indian. She was the eighth daughter of the shaman, so all the powers passed to her. So my father was born. My father was born in 1890. My mother was born in 1911. So my father was 21 years older than my mother. Did anybody take a sigh of, oh, okay. And I'm not gonna tell you how old I am because I'm timeless. So don't you feel that way? You know, you catch your image someplace and you go, who is that? I feel the same. And so I grew up in Harlem. When my parents married, and the reason that I grew up in Harlem with my family is because my mother's family disowned her when she married my father. That's how it was in those days. And so I went to school. I went to Little Brown Schoolhouse with Little Brown children. And in the third grade, my parents decided I should get a better education. So they sent me where? To private school, where I was the only person of color in my class from the third grade to the eighth grade. And I remember that third grade so clearly. That's when I noticed race. Because life was one way for me at home, and it was a very different thing for me at school. And I learned how to seamlessly navigate those worlds as a way to survive and as a way to try to belong. And so in my house, we talked about race every day. Always. I don't remember not talking or thinking about race every single day. It's part of my being. And look at what I'm doing. I'm still talking about race. So I would like you to share, and literally you have about the same amount of time as I just took, but for both of you. I gave you a little extra story so I could introduce myself to you. So if you could just share with the person you're sitting next to the first time you noticed race in your life. And there might be three of you, so I'll give us about five, 6 minutes at most, maybe less. Thank you for coming.
I'm so glad you're here.
Good to see you.
Barbie Danielle, I was just on the phone with
her. Oh, really?
She sends her love.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, we had a meeting, which is why I was late here.
Oh, I don't want to interrupt you, but I haven't talked to her in a really long time. I'll talk to you after.
Yes.
What's your name?
My name is Pualani.
Pualani?
Mm-hmm.
Spell that for me.
Pualani.
Is that Hindi?
Hawaiian.
Hawaiian. Mm-hmm. Hawaiian. What does it mean?
Flower of heaven.
Ooh. What a nice name. Pualani. I like it.
One of those I can thank my parents for later.
Right.
I appreciate it when I was young because of all the nicknames.
Right. What kinds of things do people call you when you're annoying?
Pualani.
God. Did you grow up in Hawaii? Which island?
I grew up on Oahu.
Okay. And here you are in the freezing cold.
But I love it here.
Oh, you do? How did you come here? Because of school?
No, just kind of stumbled here, I'd say almost by accident. But we had friends, my husband and I had some friends. I was coming from Kazakhstan, thinking I was moving to Alaska of all places from Hawaii.
Wow.
And some friends said, well, you should stop off in Redmond to see us. I said, okay, we'll stop off briefly. We were in this rickety house trailer that was just literally falling off its frame.
Wow.
And we started thinking about cold nights in Alaska and how unprepared we were. So we said, maybe we'll stay
here
with these friends for a bit. And that stretched out into about 15 years.
Oh, my gosh. So, you never know where life is taking you, huh? Oh, welcome to...
It's always worth it. Wherever God leads.
That's right. That's right. Pualani.
Does your name mean something?
Yes. It's Shakti. It comes from... it goes with Shiva. Mm-hmm. So Shiva represents the unmanifest consciousness of the universe, and Shakti is what puts that formless into form.
Okay. That's neat.
Yeah.
A deep meaning.
Yeah, like yours. Oh, really? So, you know, these conversations can always continue. Did you learn something new about the person you were with? Anybody? Yeah. So, now that we know that we can talk about race in very personal ways, let's talk about the system. If we don't understand how the system functions, we can't address it. So what is the system? Let's look at it as if we were talking about the human system. What is the job of the human system? survival, right? And in order for the body to do what the body does, are you aware of controlling it in any way? Mostly not. Mostly not. And when you understand what goes on in the body every moment of every day, you're not usually thinking about that unless something's hurting you. Then you might be more aware of it. Or even if you hurt yourself, when you go to sleep, your body's busy repairing completely without your direction. And so the system, any system, always has a job to do. What is the job of the system of inequity? It's to churn out inequity. That's what it does. That's how it's been created. We were born into systems that we did not create. And we're born into history, much of which we do not learn, that we also did not create. And yet here we are in a system that churns out inequity that is embedded in history, which informs culture, which informs identity. But it's moved by power and economics. Power and economics is the driver of the system. It has internal components and external components, which are written there. Where people sometimes, we talk a lot about systems and structures, but let's talk about structures specifically. So in your human body, what are some of the structures that support the body in doing its job of keeping you alive? The heart, the brain, the lungs, the circulatory system. So much cells that have differentiated themselves in order to perform very specific tasks. So this system, and systems by their very nature, are quite complex. One of the ways that we can begin to grapple or continue to grapple with a system is to look at patterns and relationships. Patterns and relationships. So when we talk about structure related to the system of inequity, we're talking about the patterns and relationships among institutions. Transportation, education, healthcare, religious, spiritual organizations, and so on and so on. Media, the messaging that helps you become who you are, the culture that tells you who you are. And we're the same, but we're different. It's the point I've been making all along. That in order to be able to look at a story, any story, through the lens of race, we can identify all of these elements playing out in any story at any given time. Some are obvious, and some are hidden, and they overlap. So I'm going to give you some examples of what I'm talking about, and we'll just start with history. When this first comes on, there's no sound. So you'll let me know if you can't see. Somebody just raise your hand and I'll try to read it out loud. We're just watching a little of this. Can you see that in the back? Thank you.
was counting dead Indians back on the trails when they were killing them.
We'd see all these little kids in uniform, and we'd be wondering how come they're like that. We weren't dressed like that. These little kids were.
I remember being younger, growing up on a reservation, and being told, don't trust white people, don't listen to them. You know, they're told why.
The government schools are constantly being built and hospitals added. We bring them in, clean them up, and start them on their way to civilization.
I would ask social services and human services audience, how many people know about residential boarding schools? How many people here do? This never makes it into the history books. This is never taught.
Why did those schools get started, and who started them, and what was the rationale behind it?
Why were those schools started? Who started them, and what was the rationale? Why were those schools started? What was the purpose of boarding schools that happened throughout the United States and Canada and Australia, connected to destroy culture? But why do you need to do that? What? And what kind of control are you looking for? For what purpose? Stolen resources like the land. But in order to do that, it has to be a message that is so woven into the fabric of the culture that you don't even think about it twice. I have not yet been to a school anywhere in the United States, and I have been to many, many schools, where the native population was more than 0.5%. When I go to schools and organizations, I look out and I see, where are the people of color? Has anybody ever looked up why there's so few people of color in Oregon?
Sundown laws.
That was one way it was expressed, the sundown laws. But this culture, this widespread culture that normalizes inequity, that normalizes cultural ways of being, that normalize who belongs and who doesn't, who's good and who is not. We bring them in, we clean them up, we civilize them, and send them on their way. What were they doing? Sweeping the ground. We have to feel it, not just know the information. We have to feel it, because this longing to have and control and to measure everything by money and stuff has seeped so deeply into our culture that we can't escape it, and definitely not individually. So, history. How many of you feel like you really learned history when you were in school? I didn't. I would always take every history book, every time we learned about another, Egypt was as close as we got. And they even made Egyptian people white people, because you have to justify the intelligence that exists while at the same time you're saying these people who are black and brown and yellow and red, they're inferior, they're not as good. You didn't create this. So this is the sticking point. If we look at history long term, and we look at who came to the Americas for the purpose of the land and stuff, those people who came primarily were people who had already been traumatized. Do we know about post-traumatic stress, right? Post-traumatic stress passes down generation to generation to generation. But how much healing is actually going on? Not all that much. So we must be able to analyze it. I want to show you another way of considering this through art. So Kerry James Marshall is the person we're going to see. He's a muralist. This takes a little finagling, so hold on a sec. San Francisco Museum of Modern Art.
One of my primary interests as an artist, as a painter, has always been to show things that are rarely shown, to reveal things that are hidden, to see the unseen. And so one of the things that I noticed in terms of the historical narrative in the United States is that there are certain aspects of the historical narrative that are never really spoken of, and they're never really revealed. And while we talk about the heroism and the foresight and the vision of the founding fathers, what we almost never talk about with the founding fathers is the fact that at the time that they were writing the Declaration of Independence, you know, speaking about liberty and justice and equality amongst human beings, almost all of them were being supported and sustained by generations of people who had no access to any of the liberty that they talked about, neither access to the kind of capital that they that was required to sustain that kind of lifestyle. The project is organized around showing how slavery was an integral part to the life of Monticello and Mount Vernon. But it's always the element that is sort of not shown. It's like when Gilbert Stuart came to Portland with George Washington, he didn't put a slave in there. You know, like they didn't do that. When George Washington married Martha, Martha had 320 slaves of her own when he married her. Now, the anamorphosis has to do with the fact that the kind of image that we have of the founding fathers is completely distorted. Basically, it's like what more effective device to kind of speak to the distortion that we have in history than to use anamorphosis, basically. So, okay, it's like, well, if you look at them from this angle, they look all right. But if you look at them from this angle, head on, they look completely out of whack. What I wanted to do is to have the portrait of Mount Vernon and Monticello and put in and hide in the background there, if Jefferson owned the 150 slaves, to have all 150 of them in there. So it's like, put all of them in there too, and do not continue to tell the story of who the founding fathers were without telling you that part too, all the time. And that doesn't have to be a traumatic kind of narrative, which is part of the reason why it's in a game, you know, in a visual game. I had to find ways to do that without having to draw 150 people in the picture, for one thing. And so actually the device that I hit upon to actually include the majority is the connected dots. Every one of the dots in the connected dot is a face. It's a black face. You can get a lot of figures in, and not in an obvious sort of kind of way. So they become a tool to help you to do something else in the same way that slaves were a tool to help the plantation and the house and all that stuff be able to operate.
The whole story. So how do you get to the whole story? You have to ask questions. You have to notice what's missing. You have to be curious. Tomorrow morning, we're going to spend time just looking at strategic questioning for social justice. Like, how do we do that? So we develop skills that we can use in order to do the work that we do. So what is culture? Anybody tell me what culture is?
Shared beliefs, values.
Mm-hmm. And does anybody know how this process called not noticing happens? If you look up the definition of culture in the dictionary, it's very interesting what it says. It says, the enlightenment and excellence of taste acquired by intellectual and aesthetic training. What does that mean? Should I read it again? Okay. Culture. This is from Webster's Dictionary. The enlightenment and excellence of taste acquired by intellectual and aesthetic training. If you want to go to the next definition, which is B, it says acquaintance with and taste in fine arts, humanities, and broad aspects of science as distinguished from vocational and technical skills. Like magic. It happens by magic. How many of you, I'm old enough, I know some of you are not as old as I am, remember a program on TV called Father Knows Best.
Oh, yes.
And what was that teaching us? The way a family should be. What kind of family? The perfect family. It just so happens that that perfect family is white. The structured family, the mommy, the daddy, the good manners, the good, all of it. Teaching us what to aspire towards. So, yes, I did work on Zootopia. And they did ask me to come in and look at the characters and the scripts, and they watched Cracking the Codes and did all of those kinds of things. And now I'm working on some other minor television scripts, which are, it's really interesting to me because they're so bad. This is the stuff that my grandkids watch on TV. And they're all set up the same way. So I can't tell you about the one I'm working on now, which I didn't finish it in 3 hours. It basically said, you can't achieve the goals you're saying you're trying to achieve with this kind of script. Because it's set up for the good people and the bad people. The people who are normal and the people who aren't normal. And the people who aren't normal can't ever really become normal. They have to take magic potions and do things like that so they could maybe fit in. We're still doing the same stuff. It's part of the structure of how we're taught. What is normal? What is normal? What is culture? So we've talked about history and culture, and I want to share with you something that probably many of you have seen. We're not going to watch the whole thing, but I'm going to ask you to watch it with the lens on about understanding the power of culture, and we're not going to watch the whole thing.
I'm a storyteller, and I would like to tell you a few personal stories about what I like to call the danger of the same story. I grew up on a university campus in eastern Nigeria. My mother says that I started reading at the age of 2, although I think 4 is probably close to the truth. So I was an early reader, and what I read were British and American children's books. I was also an early writer. And when I began to write at about the age of 7, stories in pencil with crayon illustrations that my poor mother was obligated to read, I wrote exactly the kinds of stories I was reading. All my characters were white and blue-eyed. They played in the snow. They ate apples, and they talked a lot about the weather, how lovely it was that the sun had come out. Now this despite the fact that I lived in Nigeria, I had never been outside Nigeria. We didn't have snow, we ate mangoes, and we never talked about the weather because there was no need to. My characters also drank a lot of ginger beer because the characters in the British books I read drank ginger beer. Never mind that I had no idea what ginger beer was. And for many years afterwards, I would have a desperate desire to taste ginger beer. But that is another story. What this demonstrates, I think, is how impressionable and vulnerable we are in the face of a story, particularly as children. Because all I had read were books in which characters were foreign, I had become convinced that books, by their very nature, had to have foreigners in them and had to be about things with which I could not personally identify. Now, things changed when I discovered African books. There weren't many of them available, and they weren't quite as easy to find as the foreign books, but because of writers like Chinua Achebe and Kamara Lai, I went through a mental shift in my perception of literature. I realized that people like me, girls with skin the color of chocolate, whose kinky hair could not form ponytails, could also exist in literature. I started to write about things I recognized. Now, I loved those American and British books I read. They stirred my imagination, they opened up new worlds for me. But the unintended consequence was that I did not know that people like me could exist in literature. So what the discovery of African writers did for me was this. It saved me from having a single story of what books are. I come from a conventional middle-class Nigerian family. My father was a professor. My mother was an administrator. And so we had, as was the norm, living domestic help who would often come from nearby rural villages. So the year I turned 8, we got a new houseboy. His name was Fide. The only thing my mother told us about him was that his family was very poor. My mother sent yams and rice and our old clothes to his family. And when I didn't finish my dinner, my mother would say, "Finish your food. Don't you know people like Fide's family have nothing?" So I felt enormous pity for Fide's family. Then one Saturday, we went to his village to visit. And his mother showed us a beautifully patterned basket made of dyed raffia that his brother had made. I was startled. It had not occurred to me that anybody in his family could actually make something. All I had heard about them was how poor they were, so that it had become impossible for me to see them as anything else but poor. Their poverty was my single story of them. Years later, I thought about this when I left Nigeria to go to university in the United States. I was 19. My American roommate was shocked by me. She asked where I had learned to speak English so well and was confused when I said that Nigeria happened to have English as its official language. She asked if she could listen to what she called my tribal music and was consequently very disappointed when I produced my tape of Mariah Carey. She assumed that I did not know how to use a stove. What struck me was this. She had felt sorry for me even before she saw me. Her default position toward me as an African was a kind of patronizing, well-meaning pity. My roommate had a single story of Africa, a single story of catastrophe. In this single story, there was no possibility of Africans being similar to her in any way, no possibility of feelings more complex than pity, no possibility of a connection as human equals. I must say that before I went to the US, I didn't consciously identify as African. But in the US, whenever Africa came up, people turned to me, never mind that I knew nothing about places like Namibia. But I did come to embrace this new identity, and in many ways, I think of myself now as African, although I still get quite irritable when Africa is referred to as a country, the most recent example being my otherwise wonderful flight from Lagos 2 days ago, in which there was an announcement on the Virgin flight about their charity walk in India, Africa, and other countries. So after I had spent some years in the US as an African, I began to understand my roommate's response to me. If I had not grown up in Nigeria, and if all I knew about Africa were from popular images, I too would think that Africa was a place of beautiful landscapes, beautiful animals, and incomprehensible people fighting senseless wars, dying of poverty and AIDS, unable to speak for themselves, and waiting to be saved by a kind white foreigner. I would see Africans in the same way that I, as a child, had seen Fide's family. This single story of Africa ultimately comes, I think, from Western literature. Now here's a quote from the writing of a London merchant called John Locke, who sailed to West Africa in 1561 and kept a fascinating account of his voyage. After referring to the black Africans as beasts who have no houses, he writes, "They are also people without heads, having their mouths and eyes in their breasts." Now, I've laughed every time I've read this, and one must admire the imagination of John Locke. But what is important about his writing is that it represents the beginning of a tradition of telling African stories in the West, a tradition of sub-Saharan Africa as a place of negatives, of difference, of darkness, of people who, in the words of the wonderful poet Rudyard Kipling, are half-devil, half-child. And so I began to realize that my American roommate must have, throughout her life, seen and heard different versions of this single story. As had a professor who once told me that my novel was not authentically African. Now, I was quite willing to contend that there were a number of things wrong with the novel, that it had failed in a number of places. But I had not quite imagined that it had failed at achieving something called African authenticity. In fact, I did not know what African authenticity was. The professor told me that my characters were too much like him, an educated and middle-class man. My characters drove cars. They were not starving. Therefore, they were not authentically African. But I must quickly add that I too am just as guilty on the question of the single story. A few years ago, I visited Mexico from the US. The political climate in the US at the time was tense, and there were debates going on about immigration. And as often happens in America, immigration became synonymous with Mexicans. There were endless stories of Mexicans as people who were fleecing the healthcare system, sneaking across the border, being arrested at the border, that sort of thing. I remember walking around on my first day in Guadalajara, watching the people going to work, rolling up tortillas in the marketplace, smoking, laughing. I remember first feeling slight surprise, and then I was overwhelmed with shame. I realized that I had been so immersed in the media coverage of Mexicans that they had become one thing in my mind, the abject immigrant. I had bought into the single story of Mexicans, and I could not have been more ashamed of myself.